and welcome to Inside the Women of Denver. I'm your host, Crystal Covington, and today we have an amazing lineup of leaders to talk about everything from business to kryptonite. Yes, I did say kryptonite. But first up, is networking the most dreaded checkbox on your to-do list? Find out the top three mistakes you might be making and how to avoid them. I'm here with Penny Brenden, owner of The Connecting Experts, and she's going to share the top three mistakes people make and how to avoid them. Penny, tell me about these mistakes. Networking is always challenging for everybody.
It is.
But what are we doing wrong?
Well, I think that a lot of times what so many people do is they just show up.
Mm-hmm.
They just show up. They don't have any intention of what they want to do or who they want to meet. And you know, really the when you have a good message, so a good message, being intentional about your networking, mm-hmm. and just being brave are three things that you can do to make the networking experience a whole lot better.
Yeah.
And you know, when you just show up somewhere, you never know who you're gonna meet, but if you're not prepared, so you wouldn't just hop in your car and say, okay, I'm gonna drive to Vail.
Let's drive.
I mean, you have to, and you just moved here. You don't know where Vail is, right? You have to get the map out. You have to figure out how long it's gonna take you. Mm-hmm. And you know, if it's snowy, you wanna, you know, I mean, you have to be prepared.
Go with the plan. I love the term that you used, intention. And you know, that's one of the things that I really tried to focus on is actually knowing what I'm after, knowing exactly, you know, if you don't know your goals, you're just gonna end up somewhere. You're gonna end up somewhere, you're moving. You're gonna get somewhere, but is it where you want it to be?
Right.
Yeah.
And you know, networking takes time and money and effort.
Yes.
And if you're gonna spend your time, your money and your effort, then you should put a little bit of thought into it.
Yes.
And so, you know, if you're a realtor, who are your power partners? Like, who do you want to meet?
What's a power partner? That's a good terminology.
So a power partner would be someone who has the same target audience,
mm-hmm.
but is not in direct competition with you, but in partnership with you. So
okay, so they're talking to the same people, mm-hmm. but they're not doing the same business.
Correct.
Okay.
So like a realtor and a mortgage broker.
Yeah.
Great power partner.
That's an amazing combination.
Mm-hmm. And so when you go somewhere, you want to know who it is that you want to meet, mm-hmm. and have that person, like visualize that person in your mind.
Mm-hmm.
And visualization is really, really important for people to, you know, to be able to get what it is that they want to go there for.
Yeah.
Right? And so, I also, once you get there, to have a good message.
Yes.
So to be intentional and not, I call it throwing up all over someone. We've all had that experience where you've actually gone to a networking event and someone says, well, hi, my name's Penny. And I, blah, 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 and you know.
Just vomiting their whole resume at you.
It is.
So that value statement or the 30-second, some people call it the 30-second elevator speech, is that what you mean, to kind of have something like that?
Yes. And you know, you don't want to just blurt out your 30-second promotional. You want it to be like a kind of a conversational piece where when you have something written down, mm-hmm. which comes to 30, you know, to your 30-second promotional, to have it in your brain where you can just take different pieces of that when you're in a conversation with someone. And it kind of goes along with you being intentional. So you know who it is, you know, mm-hmm. what it is that you're gonna say. And then, you know, really being brave in being able to talk to people that you don't know.
Yes, that's huge. So that, I still struggle with this, but I'd say that was one of my biggest struggles when it came to networking, mm-hmm. was actually being able to just walk up and talk to somebody. I found that the easiest thing was to actually go up to groups versus individual people,
mm-hmm.
because you can just kind of walk up to them and then eventually they go, okay, this girl is standing here with us. Maybe we should include her in the conversation. They kind of split open. That's my tactic.
Well, and you know what's so interesting about that is that when you go to an event, why don't you try to do a little bit of research beforehand?
Mm-hmm.
Find out who the facilitator is.
Smart.
Go and talk to that person. And, you know, another awesome thing to do when you go to a networking event, because they always typically have registration tables.
Yes.
And so those people that are behind the registration table, they know everybody.
Oh, yeah. So it's like the administrative assistant at the front desk.
Exactly. So you go up there, you're signing in, you're getting your little name tag, and you're saying, so, this is the first time I've ever been here.
Yeah.
Can you introduce me to Crystal? I've never met Crystal, and this is my first time here.
That's a great tip. Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then the other thing, too, is when you see someone who has eyes as big as saucers, and they're scared to death, and they're standing in the outskirts, mm-hmm. then you just want to go up and try to make that person feel a little bit better because they're scared.
Yeah. Make a friend, you know, yes. give them an opportunity to connect.
Well, and what that does is it makes you look like a rock star.
Oh, yeah.
Because you helped them because they were afraid, and now you're friends.
And it's kind of an easy connection because it's like they were really looking for you, and so you can probably make the connection a lot faster versus, you know, kind of trying my strategy of jumping into a conversation already going.
Exactly.
All right, and what was that third tip, that third mistake that we make?
So the third mistake is saying, what do you do?
Oh my gosh, that is my least favorite networking question. Mm-hmm. I feel like that's what people do when they have never networked before and they don't have a clue what to say or how to start a conversation.
Yep.
Yeah, that's like the first keynote. I know that they're not heavy networkers.
Well, and so instead of doing that, say, gosh, is this your first time here? Or do you know anybody here?
Right, start a conversation, like engage. Mm-hmm. Perfect. Well, thank you so much for those tips. That was so useful, and I'm going to start using them right away.
Well, very good. Thank you so much, Crystal.
Great to talk with you.
Great to talk with you, too.
Wow. Doesn't that make networking feel easier? Next up, we'll be talking about the modern-day kryptonite that's wiping out superwomen everywhere. Stay tuned. We're talking to Jess Bonasso of Radiant Self-Care, often referred to as the self-care goddess. And for all of you superwomen out there, we're talking about your kryptonite. If you're feeling wiped out day in and day out, there's one critical factor that might be taking you down. And Jess is here to tell us all about it. All right, Jess, I need to know, what is this kryptonite that's burning me out?
All right, well, it's actually something that's been happening for about the last 100 years or so since women as a whole entered the workforce. You know, back in the 100 years ago or whatever, we were taking care of our families, and that was our primary responsibility, which is great. That was great. And then we decided to become the providers and help out and start bringing home the bacon and frying it up in a pan and all
love
of that.
Bacon.
Yeah, me too. So the problem started then, and I think really, you know, my degree, my undergraduate degree, was in sociology, so I am fascinated by all things sociological, and so what's happened is a sociological conditioning of sorts, which has literally put women in a position where now they're not just the women who stay at home and they're the nurturers and the providers, the ones that take care of the family, but they're also having to help provide, which is not a bad thing, because we want to be considered equals.
Yeah.
But it's wiping us out. We're literally
doing all of it.
Yeah. I mean, we're juggling everything. We're working all day long, and then we're coming home and working a second shift.
Yes.
Which is taking care of our family. And even if you don't have kids, which I don't have kids, but I have two dogs and a man at home. I mean, just making dinner every night, making breakfast every morning, making sure that the laundry's clean, going grocery shopping. It's just on top of being an entrepreneur, it's a lot, right?
Yeah, I'm getting tired just listening to you.
Exactly. So you know, what's happening is we're struggling to juggle it all. So the problem is the sociological conditioning that's happened as a result of us entering the workforce. And unfortunately, the symptoms that are starting to show up are signs of burnout. And in fact, there's a study that was done in 2015 which found that two-thirds of the female population is actually struggling with stress-related issues related to burnout.
Oh, I can understand it.
It's a huge part of the population.
Yeah, that's a big proportion.
Yeah, and a large part of it, I believe, personally, is because of what I would call this masculinization of women, where coming into the workforce now, we're forced to operate in this sort of masculine role and capacity.
Yeah.
Not a bad thing necessarily, but I don't think we've really figured it all out yet, because too many of us are still stressing for it to be resolved.
So it sounds like we just haven't found that balance between where we were and, you know, who we are today. And we're trying to kind of figure out, you know, what is our positioning, and it sounds, I mean, that's a stressful process. I mean, anytime we change where we were just going from one job to another job.
Right.
You know, when we switch jobs, it's one of the most stressful transitions. Moving to a new home is a stressful transition. So, you know, having this societal change where we're still trying to figure out where we fit and, you know, what are our responsibilities and all that kind of stuff. I mean, that would be stressful.
It is. And I think one of the biggest problems that we're facing with a lot of this is, you know, in the study that I referenced earlier, the 75% of women who are struggling with anxiety and stress-related mm-hmm. issues, only 40% of those women actually went in and got help for it.
Wow.
So a lot of us don't even know what we don't know. We're completely ignorant that really what's happening is we're being forced to come in and being expected to perform like a man, which is, like I said, it's great from an equality standpoint, mm-hmm. but it's very different for a woman to come in and operate in a masculine role, which is like action-oriented, goal-oriented, task-oriented kind of activities. It requires a lot more energy for a woman to manage that for long periods of time than it does for a man at a biological level. So it's really important for women to understand that if they're dealing with stress, one of the things they really need to start thinking about is how can they balance their energy more effectively? Mm-hmm. You know, it's not really about time management so much as it is about energy management.
Okay, so what is the key to starting to do that? So I hear a lot of the use of the terminology energy lately, mm-hmm. but I don't necessarily understand what that means for me and how do I do things like balance my energy or even consider what that is for me.
Right. That's a really great question. So, you know, when I think of energy, I think of how do I feel in my body? Do I feel mm-hmm. energized? Do I feel alive? Mm-hmm. Right? Or am I feeling exhausted? Am I feeling depleted?
Okay.
So for me, the energy piece that I'm talking about is how much energy do I have to get through the day?
Like so literally energy to get through the day.
Yeah. So if you think about the Energizer Bunny, right? It'll keep going and going and going. And if it's, you know, got the right batteries, it'll go forever.
Yeah.
But if it doesn't have the right batteries, it's going to run out of steam at some point. And that's what's happening to us is we're running out of steam.
So how do we re-energize ourselves then?
So I think the solution for women to kind of counterbalance the masculinization of women that's taken place over the last 100 years is mm-hmm. to, you know, we were on the more feminine side before. Now we are on the more masculine side. What I'd love to see is for women to find that happy middle ground.
Yes.
And kind of combine the masculine and feminine. And so when it comes to energy management, making sure that you're engaging in activities throughout your day, your week, your month, on a regular, consistent basis that are energy fueling in nature is extremely important for a woman. And if women are just... if they're focused on efficiency and productivity and that's it, they're going to run out of steam. And so you want to think about, how can I refuel myself halfway through the day when I'm starting to feel a little bit burned out?
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe you go take 5 minutes and go meditate in your car.
Oh,
or go for a walk in the park. You know, you want to do activities that fuel you. So it could be exercise related. It could be listening to music.
So like a
really
personal
anything.
A personal decision, something that personally fuels me individually.
Yeah.
There's not like specific things that I should be doing, but just think about what energizes me.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. And there are some things that energize all of us, like, you know, making sure you get enough rest is incredibly important. It's incredibly important. And a lot of women just don't. And then also making sure you eat 3 times a day.
Yeah.
Women are notorious for skipping meals.
Breakfast.
It's terrible.
Coffee.
It's terrible. Yeah.
Venti.
So, you know,
venti
just
breakfast.
Yeah. So taking care of your basic needs, you know, just that by itself can mm-hmm. really make a huge difference. And then just not booking yourself so solid that you have that go nonstop sort of thing happening all the time.
Yeah.
It's too much for us.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for those tips.
You're welcome.
And ladies, energize yourselves.
That's right.
All right. Says Jess. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Now that you've got the cure for kryptonite, it's time to get connected. If you're an entrepreneur, you'll want to get to know this woman. She's on a mission to empower entrepreneurs to keep making change in the world. Check it out. As an entrepreneur, it can be easy to throw in the towel if you don't have a support group of people who are in the trenches and honest about their experiences. That's why Kristin Darga founded Impact Founder, to connect entrepreneurs to authentic stories that empower them to keep pushing towards their goals. Kristen's going to tell us about her program and some of the incredible things she's been working on. So, Impact Founder, tell us a little bit about it.
Yeah, so I started Impact Founder as a project. It wasn't ever meant to be a business. Um, I I saw a lot of different struggles in the community and entrepreneurs and my friends and my clients as a coach. And there were a number of suicides that had happened, about three in the matter of a couple of months, around the country. And I just tuned into what was happening with entrepreneurs and that it's not always easy, even when your business is going well. Mm-hmm. So I started Impact Founder, which is authentic conversations and storytelling about what it's really like to be an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
Successes and challenges. And like I said, it's not always when your business is struggling. Sometimes your business is doing incredibly well and you're having a personal struggle.
Yeah, at the same time.
Yeah.
When I looked at some of the stories, it was really remarkable to see that some of these people, and I think that's kind of one of the points of it, is to kind of show the juxtaposition of the fact that, you know, yes, I sold my business for $1 million, but I'm struggling with depression and I'm in the middle of a divorce.
Right.
And these are things that happen that no one really talks about. We, on the outside, we just see, oh my God, they just made $1 million.
Right.
But we don't know the struggle. And it makes it look like when we are going through the struggle that there's something wrong with me. There's something mm-hmm. wrong with, you know, what I'm going through is unique, mm-hmm. but it's not.
Well, it is. Everyone's unique, right? So we have that. Our struggle has our own things that we have on it that we put on. Our life is different than someone else's. But yet, a lot of the conversations that I have had, the recordings that we've done on audio, you know, the photos that we have in the quotes, they tend to repeat the same stories.
Yeah.
So they may sound a little different, but they're all very similar. You know, this year is the first full year that I've done two Denver Startup Week events. Uh-huh. And those had a lot of stories in one spot. So I recorded a lot for one event. And at that event alone, you know, we had people reading what was written before going, oh, wow, that's like exactly what I'm going through. And that was really great to see that that's exactly what we're doing it for. So people mm-hmm. can relate to it and build a community.
It's a connection.
Yeah, totally. Totally. So this is an example of one of our pictures here. Brad Feld is a local VC. He founded Techstars and Foundry Group.
Wow.
And he actually talks about when his business is doing well. And then he had a significant depressive episode that lasted about 6 months.
Oh my gosh.
And so his quote is about that, you know, just being strong and being able to share that. He encourages people through his blog and through different areas to be able to share what's really happening. So your investors know, if you have investors, because your investors actually want you to succeed. They want you to do well. They're investing in you.
Yes.
They're not just investing in your company.
So you tell these stories both through images like this, and then how else are you, I think I've seen on your Twitter channel, you have kind of the images there. How are they being shared?
Yeah, so we have galleries that we curate for different spaces. We also rent galleries. We share on social media, so Instagram, Twitter, a lot of Twitter. Yeah. We also share on Facebook. We have not only the pictures, but we also have audio stories. So we're sharing a little bit more in depth. Yeah. So some of the pictures just have quotes, sort of like Humans of New York. And then some of the other pictures have short audio stories.
Okay.
People can submit from all over the world.
Wow.
And that's why we created this pilot to be able to tell stories through audio. So we just have a format people can go through and share their story from anywhere.
So what's been one of the most impactful stories that you've heard?
Wow. I think the most impactful story that I've heard wasn't actually shared through Impact Founder.
Really?
So people share stories with me on the street, you know, in meetings that aren't necessarily about telling their story. Uh-huh. And, you know, I had people reach out to support me and what I was doing and share about, you know, how the experience of seeing me build Impact Founder and even participating in one of the pictures in the past mm-hmm. had opened up a part of their life that they'd been hiding from.
Oh.
So this one individual, he went on to do video like stories of his own. So he opened up about, you know, almost taking his life by suicide and just being incredibly strong and powerful and real about that time of his life, which he'd always kept really hidden and close to him. And he said that sharing that just completely empowered him. And, you know, he thought it'd be something that people wouldn't relate to or mm-hmm. want to know about him. And he found that people actually you know, encouraged him or reached out to him about their own things that they were dealing with.
Did he talk about how people responded to him? I mean, what do people say when you share? Beautiful.
Yeah, just community and love. I mean, that's the basic sense, you know, of what we're doing is building community so that you don't have to be alone or isolated. Yeah. So you can keep making change. And that's an awesome example of someone who went on beyond Impact Founder. You know, he has, he was in the original exhibit and now he's grown, you know, that authenticity in his life. And, you know, he's built this community around him.
Beautiful.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, thanks for sharing a little bit about Impact Founder and what you're doing. I think it's amazing. And I'm so glad you're out there helping to support entrepreneurs in this way.
Thanks, Crystal.
Thank you. What an inspiring program. Next up, we're talking to a woman who's all about results. This business consultant gets things done in a major way, and she's not slowing down anytime soon. Take a look. I'm here with Bobi Siembieda, owner of Conrad Business Results, and she's going to share tips that will help you clarify, simplify, and achieve your vision for success. Hey, Bobi.
Hey, Crystal, how are you?
Great. Sounds like you've got some amazing tips to share with us.
Well, you know, we heard one earlier, and that is that every entrepreneur needs a peer group.
Ah, yes.
They need that encouragement. They need that support. They need that kick in the seat of the pants. They need like-minded people to draw them out of themselves. So they definitely need their peer group. They also need a good coach, someone who's going to help them play at business the best that they can possibly be.
Good
and
stuff.
The third thing that they need is a good system. That's where I come in.
Oh, systematize. System. All right.
Yes. As an EOS implementer, I get them to focus on six critical components of their business. And in doing that, we achieve what we call vision, traction, healthy. Making sure that they have one vision crystal clear so they know where they're going, how they're going to get there. Traction, that the tools and the system that I bring to bear will help them become more disciplined and accountable in achieving every part of that vision. And healthy in the sense that, you know, leaders don't always share. They don't always collaborate. It's just not in their nature. They sit in their seat and they just command and lead, right? So we want the team, we want that leadership team working together as a cohesive team so they can get more out of their business. And what we say is, as goes the leadership team, so goes the rest of the organization. Eventually getting that much more clear, that much more manageable, that much more controlled, and dare I say fun and profitable.
Fun and profits together, that's awesome. So let's go back to this vision piece. And you know, I remember learning in business school about a BHAG or the big, hairy, audacious goal. Do you kind of go in line with something like that, or are you thinking more? I've heard some new terminologies and some new definitions of what a vision is. But what does a vision really mean for a business, and how do you create one? That I mean, it sounds like it's one of the most important pieces. So how do you create a vision?
We take a very broad view of it. So every good vision needs to answer 8 questions. So we work with the teams to make sure that they know what their core values are. Now, before everybody groans about core values, because they've become trite, right? Every MBA program back in the 90s said you must have core values. Well, they're more important today than ever before, because it helps you define your culture of your organization. And it actually determines who the right people are that you want to play with every day in your business and work with side by side in your business every day. So we say, what are your core values? And then what's your core focus? So I'm sure you've all watched Simon Sinek's Why program, right? Well, our core focus is all about, what's your why? What gets your blood pumping every day about what you do in your business? And then what do you do? What do you do with superior skill, your niche? That's your core focus. And then the big target, that core target, that's your BHAG. That's your big, hairy, audacious goal. Where does this organization go? So when I step on this ship with you and I'm sailing across this water, where are we going together? So it's going to create alignment with the people that you're trying to attract to your business. And it's also going to make sure everyone knows what that big thing is in the horizon. But while I love the work that was done on the BHAG, it's just too big and hairy and audacious a lot of times and not measurable enough. So we really like to bring it down to the ground and make sure it can be big, it can be hairy, it can be really, really big and hairy and wow, right? And make the hair go up on your arms, but we want it to be measurable. I want it to be smart. So I want to say, you know, I work with my teams to help coach them through that and to come up with a really smart goal from there. And then the other piece of it is we want to know their marketing strategy. We want to know their three-year picture, visualizing what the company's going to look like in three short years, taking that 10-year target or that big target and bring it down to the ground so that we can not only visualize it, get people to see it and feel it, because we can get them to see it and feel it, we can get them there that much faster. But then we also then bring them into their annual plan with their one-year planning. We create a 90-day world of priorities for them. So we're getting employees engaged, because employees today in business, we've got about 13% of our U.S. employees are engaged in their businesses.
That's such a small percentage.
It's
so that means
horrible,
most people go to work and they're like, I don't feel like doing this.
Complacency. But the problem is it's not their fault a lot of times. It's we as the leaders aren't doing a good job of making sure they know how they're how they contribute to the organization, what the big picture is in our organizations, and getting them aligned with that and bringing them in. There's a lot of wasted potential in organizations today.
So once you have, you know, that vision, that plan all put together, how do you keep it going and keep communicating it within an organization? I feel like that is the most challenging part.
Yes, it is. Well, we have something that we call the meeting pulse. And our meeting pulse is, we have an annual meeting pulse, we have a quarterly meeting pulse, and there's a weekly meeting pulse. So this weekly meeting pulse is a game changer. It gets companies meeting, gets leadership teams and departments meeting 90 minutes a week, and at least 45 to 60 minutes of that 90-minute meeting at a leadership team level is doing nothing but solving issues in the business. So
real problems,
and we're baking accountability into that meeting, making sure that people have to-dos, that they're doing those. We're measuring, one of the components in the system is data, so we're making sure that people who are accountable to certain numbers in the business are reporting in on whether or not they're being hit or missed. The goals that they've decided, the rocks, if you will, that they've adopted for that 90-day quarterly period, they're reporting in on whether those are on track or off track. So it's alive every day, every week.
Keeping it moving.
Keeping it moving
it's
in
like
the company every day.
It's like having a regular Friday date, like in your relationship. You have date night. Always have date night and make sure it's on the calendar.
Absolutely true. That's why it's a system. It's not just one piece. It's a very holistic view at the business.
Nice. I love that. So it sounds like this is not a campaign. This is an ongoing thing.
Totally.
And, you know, to continue that conversation and have that vision.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much for sharing those amazing tips. I hope you use those in your business.
Thank you very much.
Oh my gosh. I hope you took notes, because that was value packed. Next up, we're talking skincare. Hey, we're talking with Andrea Sims, skincare expert. And she's going to share a few tips for great skin all year round and lash conditioning, something I have never heard of until today. So, how do I keep my skin looking good?
Well, skin, lashes, it's all about taking care of yourself, right?
Yes.
And so, with skin, the number one thing I can just share with you is don't wear makeup to bed. That is like the worst thing you can do. There's oils, right? I will tell you, I was just like you. Before I started this, I would go to bed with all of my makeup on. I'd use a bar of soap in the shower the next day. And honestly, it could have been lava soap. Don't use soap on your skin. The suds aren't good for you. So it's really kind of interesting that I ended up in this industry. There's a lot of reasons for that, but I will tell you, don't wear makeup to bed and make sure you take it off with something. And one of the products that I would recommend is just like an eye makeup cloth remover or one of the towelettes. One of the things that I think is really neat about our particular brand, if any of you, it's nice and soft, but if any of you have children and if any of them have ever drawn on themselves with a permanent Sharpie, then these will actually, you gotta rub a little bit. Or really, okay, rub
it's
harder,
coming off.
But
it's
it
coming
is
off.
Coming off.
Wow.
So it does come off, and if we took time, I actually have my kids draw on my face, and it absolutely,
no, you don't.
Yeah, I did. I have a video on that too. So make sure to take your makeup off at night. It will actually age you faster than anything that's out there. So
well, that's easy to just kind of keep next to the bed. So if I'm having one of those, I've done too much today kind of days, I can just kind of lay it.
Yes, yes. And I'll tell you this, 20% of how your skin looks is hereditary. 80% of how your skin looks is how you treat it. Yes. So please make sure to take off your makeup. And I would also tell you to exfoliate. I'm actually partnered with the top two most well-known dermatologists in the world. Uh-huh. And the three tips they give everyone is exfoliate, exfoliate, exfoliate. and I'll tell you, we have a phenomenal tool. This is a micro exfoliator.
Okay.
So it doesn't hurt. It has almost 200 tiny little stainless steel needles.
Yeah, it's like little needles in this.
Mm-hmm. And so you use it to roll your face, your lips, your neck, and it's micro exfoliating. So it's going to produce a more firm complexion, less lined mm-hmm. appearance. We're literally watching people turn back the hands of time by like 10 years from
wow.
incorporating this into their daily routine. I will tell you, you know, the size of the needles matters. You don't want to find something that has super long needles. It's not supposed to be a meat grinder.
Oh my gosh, that's what I thought of. I'm like, this is a medieval weapon.
No, it's not. But I will tell you, it's something that's been going on for many, many years. But the size of the needles matters, and it's supposed to be micro exfoliation.
Okay.
So fine lines and wrinkles gone, firm complexion. Yeah, it's amazing. But exfoliation is going to be key as well.
Good stuff. Very unexpected on this.
Yep. And this only takes a minute. Anything okay. more, and it's too much.
Okay.
So you want to hear about the lashes?
Absolutely. I have never heard of lash conditioning before. You're the first person I really need to know what this is.
Okay, so conditioning your lashes. Our lashes are just like our hair. And most of us condition our hair so that it's stronger, it's fuller, and it doesn't break, right?
Yeah.
So conditioning your lashes is going to do the same thing.
Oh.
It's going to allow them, give them moisture.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to give it nourishment. It's going to make them stronger, fuller, darker, longer.
Okay.
Because by conditioning your lashes, you're actually allowing your lashes to go through their full growth cycle instead of breaking off somewhere in the middle. And right?
I never thought of any of this. I never would have thought of my eyelashes like my hair. And I never realized they have any sort of cycle. I just thought they're the same ones I've had since I was 12.
And that's what a lot of people think.
Mm-hmm.
So in using a lash conditioning serum, it's really super easy to apply. You just put it on like you would a liquid eyeliner.
Okay.
So it's just one swipe on each eye. It dries in 90 seconds. It moisturizes, it nourishes, it conditions the lashes. And I mean, this is the real deal.
Nice.
I don't have falsies on.
Ooh.
And they're longer, fuller, thicker than they've ever been. I will admit I have mascara on them.
Of course.
But I do have some incredible before and afters, and they're touching my eyebrows at times. So I might have to trim them, but
they are very long.
Yeah. So anyway, it's not something people think about, and believe me, before I got into this, I never thought about it either. I'm a mom to two awesome kids.
Aww.
I was a corporate trainer in my past, and I was just looking for a way to diversify our income, and suddenly found this, figured out how to fit it into the nooks and crannies of my full-time corporate job and the kids' schedules, and I don't know, 6 months later, I retired from my corporate work, and
oh my goodness, congrats.
Yeah, thank you, and so I knew nothing about skincare, and now I just help others to either get great skin or help them start businesses for themselves.
Oh, great stories. Well,
thank
you so much for sharing a little bit about exfoliation and lash conditioning.
Absolutely.
And a little bit about your story, which is amazing.
Well, thank you.
Great to
have
you.
Thanks.
Thanks for watching Inside the Women of Denver. Always remember that you deserve to be seen, heard, and known. I'll see you next time.